Hello everyone, in this video we are going to discuss another example of round robin scheduling algorithm, but in this example we have CPU burst time and also IO burst time. So in the last video that I discussed about round robin scheduling algorithm, we only had CPU burst time there, right? And we saw there how to solve those type of problem, but here you also have IO here, so you have to see how to solve this type of problems. So always remember, when there is IO, right? So once a process starts running, it will complete its CPU burst. And so here the cycle is like, first CPU burst, then again IO burst, and after this again another CPU burst, right? This is the pattern here. So once a process completes its IO burst, it will again enter the ready queue, right? So this is very important to remember here, right? And I have already told how to solve round robin scheduling problems, right? You have to maintain a ready queue. Right, so now let's maintain the ready queue here. This is the ready queue, and also we'll maintain a list of process undergoing IO here in this other list. So let's start drawing the Gantt chart for this, right? So at time, okay, first at time 0, P1 arrives into the ready queue. Since there is only one process in the ready queue, let's give the the time quantum here is time quantum, okay, not here, let me write it somewhere else. So time quantum, so this is round robin, right? So there will be some time quantum, so this is here 3 units of time. So let's schedule the process P1 first from 0 to you can schedule it from at maximum of 3 quantum, right? And the first CPU burst is 6, so you can schedule only from 0 to 3, right? Because I mean, you can schedule in round robin at max, you can schedule it till the time quantum, right? So this is 3, and the remaining CPU burst will be 3 for this. And at time 3, if you see, okay, I forgot one more thing. And at time 3, you have to also see at time 3, another process P2 would have already arrived here, right, in this ready queue, right? And this P1 will be removed from here and you will end it at the tail of the queue, because P2 has arrived before P1 has completed, right? So P1 has completed time 3, but P2 would have arrived at time 2 only in the ready queue. That's why after P1 you have P2 in the ready queue, and since P2 completes at 3, right, and its CPU burst is remaining, you will again put back P1 into the ready queue, but at the tail of the ready queue. So that's what I have discussed in my last video. Now you will give time to which one? P2. And also we have to note here, there is IO also here, right? So let's give time to P2, and P2 again can run at maximum 3 quantums of time. That means this will become 6, and it will run till 6, right? And at time 6, if you see, before this only, P3 would also have entered the ready queue, right? Now, I mean, P2 has completed, and let's move back P2 again to tell the tail of the queue. This is done, and now again give the time to P1 again, 3 units of time, from 6 to 9, right? And its first CPU burst is done. That way it will go for IO from 9 to 19. 9 plus 10 is 19. So let's remove P1 from here and put this into the IO, because it won't be in the ready queue now, because it will go into the waiting state, right? Till 19 we do the IO. Now we have P3. P3 CPU burst time is 3, and maximum it can get is 3. So give it all the time from 9 to 12. This is done, and it will go for the IO from 12 plus 5, it is 17. Remove P3 from here, put it in the IO state, I mean the waiting state. 12 to 17 will go the IO, right? Now you have only one process at time 12, right? So this will complete IO at 19, this will complete at 17. So at time 12 you have only one process, that is P2. Let's give the time to P2 till how much? Till 3 quantum, till 15, right? and this will become 3. Now again at 15 also, right? So this will, I mean, this will only be there in the ready queue, right? Because this has not gone to IO till now. So at time 15, you have only one process P2. So let's give the CPU to P2 again. So that means from 15 to 3 is remaining for it, and 3 is the maximum. So 15 to 18, let's give it to P2, and this is done. P2's first CPU burst is done. It will go for IO now from 18 plus 15, right? That's 33. Till 33, it will do the IO. Now we are at time 18, right? So this is also done. Remove it from here. Now at time 18, right? Okay, this P3 will complete his IO 17, right? P3 will complete the IO 17 and enter the ready queue, correct? At 17, no other process, right? This is done. Both are doing IO. Now let's give the, so for P3, this is IO is done, CPU burst is 4, but the maximum you can give is, so not for P1, this is, sorry, I forgot. So for IO for P3 is done, sorry, I forgot. P3 is done, right? So P3 will get the CPU now, and maximum it can get is 3 quantums of time, so 18 to 21, right? And you need to check again. See, now it is going to do till 21, right? P3. But its remaining CPU burst is only 2, right? So it cannot go till 21. So maximum it can go is till 20 only, because CPU burst is only 2 units of CPU burst is remaining. And this is done, and P3 will terminate. Now at time 20, if you check, right, before this, whatever anything happened, right, if you see at time 19, P1 is also entering the ready queue. So let's bring back P1 to the ready queue, because before 20 it have entered the ready state, right? So let's delete this. So we already know the time quantum is 3, and now this P1 has entered the ready queue. Let's give the time to P1. So maximum is 3, so from 20 to 23 P1 will run. This will, remaining will be 1. Now let's check at 23. So this has already terminated, I mean done the IO. And time 23 also, we only have P1 again remaining. So give the remaining time, this has 1 unit of time remaining. So give to P1 itself, because there are no other process till 24. And this is done. This is, the P1 has also terminated. Now see, P2 will complete his IO. This is the only process remaining, and this will complete its IO at time 33, right? That means from 24 to 33, CPU will just remain idle, because there is no other process, right? Now this will complete its IO at 33, remove this from here, enter into the ready queue, and this will, it has 6 units of CPU burst time remaining at last. It will complete this. 33 to 39 is P2, right? So this is done. So all the process has terminated now, right? This is also done. So all the process has terminated now. So this is the Gantt chart for this, and this is how you solve problem involving IO. So other than the normal round robin scheduling algorithm, where you only have CPU burst, right? Other than that, you also have to take care of this IO. So once IO is done, you have to also bring those process back into the ready queue. So you should remember this. Now let's calculate the numbers. Average turnaround time, average response time, average waiting time, serialization, throughput for this. Start time, completion time, turnaround time, waiting time, and response time. First, start time for P1 is 0. For P2 it's 3, and P3 it's 9. Completion time of P1 is 24. What about P2? P2 is 39. What about P3? P3 is 20. Right? Turnaround time is completion time minus arrival time. Waiting time is TAT, turnaround time minus total CPU burst time minus total IO burst time, right? And at last we have response time. This will be equal to start time minus completion arrival time, right? So let's do TAT, CT minus AT, 24, 37, 16. Waiting time is TAT minus, this can also be considered as TAT minus, you can do plus here, this also, right? This is same as TAT minus CPU BT minus IOBT, right? I mean TAT minus total, I mean you have to subtract total burst time from TAT, right? So the total burst time in this case is 20, 24 minus 20 is 4, here it is 15 plus 16, 21 plus 30, again 37 minus 30 is 7, at last we have 5 plus 3, 8 plus 2, 10, so this is 6 here, right? RT start time minus 80, 0, 1, 5, right? We have got all these numbers, and let's see if I'm not going to calculate this. If you want to calculate the average turnaround time, average waiting time, average response time, right? So average TAT, let's say, right? So this will be equal to how much? 24 plus 37 plus 16 by 3, right? Then average waiting time will be equal to 4 plus 7 plus 6 by 3. And at last average response time equal to 1 plus 5 by 3. These are the numbers. Let's also calculate the CPU utilization. Total time is here 0 to 39, so 39 units of time. And in this, if you see 39 minus, you subtract the idle time, right? 24 to 33. So this is 9 units of time. 200 30 by 39 into 100 is the CPU utilization, right? And the percentage of idle time will be 9 by 39 into 100, because 9 units of time the CPU was idle. So percentage of idle CPU idle time will be equal to 9 by 39 into 100, because for 9 units of time the CPU was idle. And at last we have throughput, total number of process here is 3, and the schedule length here is 39 minus 0, 1 by 13 basically, right? So these are all the numbers for here, and I hope that you have understood how to solve this problem where we have both IO and CPU burst time, and you have to do it using round robin scheduling algorithm. Thank you.